everyone, welcome back to my channel and to another video. I hope you're all having a good day. In today's video, I'm going to be sharing my top 10 money saving tips for sewing. So I recently asked over on my community tab here on YouTube if there were any other kind of videos or video topics or anything that anyone would like me to make. I was just thinking of ideas for future videos and topics I could cover and things like that. And something that came up quite a few times was how to save money in sewing. So sewing isn't really a cheap hobby, is it? I think people think sometimes that we sew to save money when in reality it probably costs us more money than anything because fabric is not cheap, and nor is thread, and nor is electricity and everything else that comes with sewing as a hobby. So I thought I'd share today 10 ways that I try to save money in my own sewing life and sewing journey. And they do include a couple of things that I want to try and be better at as well. So I hope they'll be helpful to you. So before I get into sharing my top tips, I'll just quickly share what I'm wearing today. So today I'm wearing a very old pair of Sapphire trousers by Tilly and the Buttons. And I've just paired it with a really nice linen knit top that I got ages ago from Next. And this is one of my favourite outfits. It's just really nice and comfy to throw on in the morning on a nice warm day. And the Sapphire trousers are really comfy and really cool. So let's get into the video. So tip number one is to bulk buy items where you can. So I've mentioned before that I mainly sew with only black or white thread, and I bulk buy the big sort of big 1000 meter spools of Gutermann thread, I think that's how you pronounce it, only in black and white, and I keep them for sewing pretty much all of my seams. My sewing machine is a Janome sewing machine, and it seems to favour Gutermann thread. It seems to sometimes sort of play up a little bit if I ever try to change that brand. I think it's just because the Gutermann thread is really smooth. So I bulk buy big reels of black and white thread, and that's what I mainly use for sewing my seams. So even if I'm sewing with a different coloured fabric, I'll often match either to, say if it's a light colour, I'll use white thread for sewing seams. If it's a darker colour, I'll often use black, or I do have a nude one as well, which I sometimes use, but not very often. And that is just a really good way of trying to save money. So what I mean by that really is that I'll not purposely go out and buy a spool of thread in a large size that will match the current project that I'm working on. I'll sew all of my seams in either white or black, and then if necessary, I'll buy a tiny spool of thread in the colour that best match my fabric to do the top stitching or any top stitching that's needed. Sometimes you can quite easily get away with top stitching with white or black thread if your fabric does have either white or black in it, but if you really do want to colour match your top stitching, go for the smallest size if spool in that colour, and that does save you a little bit of money. I've also mentioned in the past that I tend to bulk buy buttons, and I don't always use them for every garment, but they're definitely very handy to have around. So from Amazon I bought a big bag of these coconut shell buttons, I think they're called. They're a kind of wooden looking button, and I do find that they match a lot of garments that I make, and I've used those quite a lot for dresses and tops and things like that. Another bulk buy in buttons that I have is these shell buttons. So these are really good for blouses and dresses and things, and they kind of just blend in to whatever you're making, and they're a bit of a contrast, but they tend to sort of go with everything as well. So I find it really handy to have those available because buttons aren't cheap, and finding buttons to match your garment could also be quite difficult. So that's tip number one to bulk buy. Tip number two is to save notions from old garments or garments that might have come to the end of their life. So you can save buttons, you can save zips, you can even sometimes save elastic if the elastic is still good in things. So this is something, again, that I'm trying to be better at doing. I'm really good at taking buttons off of things, and I love to save buttons. And I think perhaps as sewers, it's something that we kind of naturally do. We're often quite attracted to buttons and notions and things like that. So I think a lot of us probably automatically do save things like that. But sometimes it's quite easy to just give away a garment to charity or something without thinking about what you could actually take and reuse from that garment. Unless, of course, you do actually want to give the garment away as it is so that someone else can use it and extend its life, then of course that's absolutely fine. But if something is kind of right at the end of its life and you are going to put it in the fabric recycling, I think it's definitely worth having a look and see what you can salvage. I've recently inherited my grandma's old sewing box, and it was such fun to go through that and see what she had saved. And I don't think she ever threw anything away. There's an absolutely huge box I have of hers, full of buttons from probably everything she ever owned. Perhaps not, perhaps that's a bit of an exaggeration, but it's a very full button tin. So she obviously collected everything, and there's belt buckles and hat pins and things like that in there as well. And I think there's definitely something that I personally can learn from that, really, in just making sure that I don't ever throw things away without thinking about how I might be able to use those things in my future sewing as well. Another thing that I'm really good at saving actually is ribbons and things. So if you ever have like a gift box of, say, hand cream or soaps or anything like that, they'll often come tied with a ribbon. So I have a bit of a collection going on of ribbons that I've collected from things like that. And they do come in handy. Every so often I'll go in my box and find a bit of ribbon or a button or something that will match perfectly to whatever I'm making. So it's definitely worth saving those things, I think. Tip number three is to wait for sale days. So I've mentioned before in a few of my videos how I wait around for Minerva Craft Club VIP days, because I am a Minerva Craft Club member, and every so often, I think it's twice a year, Minerva will run a Craft Club VIP day where they have 20% off of absolutely everything on their website. So not just fabric, notions and patterns and everything else that's on there as well. So for me personally, it's really worth my while saving up my more expensive fabrics. So I love Atelier Brunette fabrics, which are quite pricey. I also love Art Gallery fabrics, and some of the more sort of high-end scale or high-end designer fabrics, which really can be quite expensive. So I have a little kind of wish list, if you like, on Minerva, where I'll save a list of my more expensive fabrics, and then when these Craft Club VIP days come around, I'll often select the ones that I most want to buy, and then I will be able to buy them with quite a good discount. So I think it's a really good way of saving money to do that. And of course, it doesn't have to be Minerva. Minerva is just the one that I tend to use. Lots of other fabric companies will tend to run sales around the same time each year. So I know that Stoff and Still, or Self Made, I keep forgetting their new name now, they run fabric sales twice a year, and I kind of know roughly now when they're going to have their summer sale. And on their website as well, you can actually keep a wish list of fabrics that you want to buy. So it's a really good way sometimes to just put off what you might impulse buy, put it onto a wish list, wait and see if any of it goes in the sale, and then buy it at more of a discount than you originally would have paid for it. My next tip is to learn about what really suits you and what you'll actually wear in your day-to-day life. So I've recently spoke a bit about this in my video, 5 Patterns That I'll Never Sew Again. I'll link that down below if you want to pop over and see that video. But I think this is probably one of the things that saved me the most money recently in my sewing journey. It's quite easy to get taken up with the latest fashions or the latest trends and things like that with fabric and patterns. And I think quite often sometimes we can make these things without ever really considering how much we're going to wear them or whether they'll actually suit us. And then they end up in the back of the wardrobe and they don't actually end up getting worn. So I am massively guilty of this myself. But I think in the past year or so, I've really got to know what suits me and what I'd actually wear in my day-to-day life. Hence more jersey sewing coming into my life. So you might have noticed, if you're a regular viewer of my videos, that I don't actually have that many patterns, and I don't actually tend to buy very many new patterns. I do buy them now and again, but I definitely don't buy loads. I have like a core collection of patterns that I use and reuse over and over again. And something that saved me a lot of money in my sewing life as well, and I've mentioned this quite a few times before, is just if you want to make a new garment, if you've seen something on the high street that you want to copy or whatever, or if you've had some inspiration from Instagram or YouTube or whatever, and you want to make something similar, don't immediately look to buying a pattern to make that garment with. Have a look at your pattern stash and see what you've already got that can be used or adapted slightly to change the garment to make it more of what you want your new garment to be. And I think just doing that and just taking a little bit of stock of what you've already got and what you can change and adapt, it really does save you a lot of money in the long run. Tip number 5 is to use free sewing patterns. So this is something that I'm definitely going to try to be better at, because I don't actually use that many free sewing patterns, and there are actually loads and loads of them around online, and so many really good ones. So if you're ever looking to make something new, particularly I think with children's patterns, it's always worth it to have a little hunt around online and see what free patterns there are available, particularly if you're trying to save money. Likewise, I think the library is a great place to go for sewing books. I know when my children were little, we used to go to the library a lot, and I used to like going into the craft section and having a look at all the craft books there, and there were a lot of free patterns available in those books, and not only patterns actually, just sort of ideas that you can use to adapt and make your own, particularly with toys and things for your home, I think. Not necessarily clothing for me at that time, I think it was more about homeware and making things for my children. But the library is a great place to go for inspiration. I think another great way of saving money when it comes to buying patterns is actually to invest in pattern books. I don't have many sewing books again, but I do have all 3 of the Tilly and the Buttons sewing books. I also have a couple of the Great British Sewing Bee books as well. And I think actually investing in a sewing pattern book is a really good way to save money, because you buy a book at, say, I don't know how much they are these days, say £20, possibly cheaper on Amazon. And within that book, you get quite a lot of sewing patterns that you can use and reuse and adapt. And buying a book outright, I think, would almost always cost you less in the long run than if you were to buy that amount of patterns singularly. So I think buying a sewing book is always a good idea, but obviously check beforehand that you are actually going to make and enjoy wearing those sewing patterns as well before you invest. I've actually lost count of the number of tips that I'm on now. I think I'm maybe on number 6, but I'm just gonna say my next tip. So my next tip is to buy PDF patterns rather than printed patterns. This of course depends on whether or not you mind not having the lovely printed out pattern in your pattern stash, but buying PDF patterns is almost always cheaper than buying printed patterns. So obviously when you buy and download a PDF pattern, you do need to have a printer and paper and things, and then obviously you need to just invest the time and effort that it takes to piece a pattern together using PDF print and tile method. So I'm trying to consider at the moment whether it actually saves me money in the long run getting my PDF patterns printed out by copy shop. I did that recently with Guthrie Garni, and it cost me an extra £4 or £5 I think to get it printed out, and actually it was so quick and easy, and it was still cheaper than buying the actual printed pattern, and it saved me all the time and effort and cost of printer ink and printer paper and things like that. So I wondered if in the long run it actually saved me money buying the pattern in PDF and then paying the extra cost to have it printed. So let me know what you think on that one. I know it's a bit of a controversial one, but overall, if you're looking to save money, buying a PDF option of a pattern is a great way to do that. They can sometimes almost be up to half the price of the printed pattern, so well worth going down that option if you do want to save money. My next tip is to save money or even make money by selling your sewing wares. So you'll know if you've followed me for a long while that I have my own Etsy shop selling personalised gifts and things for the home and things like that. And this was a great way to make extra money for me while I was on maternity leave and while I was at home with my 2 small children. So what started off with selling my handmade goods at craft fairs and church fetes and things like that developed then into me having my own Etsy shop and then my own website and then selling with Amazon as well. So I'm working in a different sort of way now, so I'm not so much working with my Etsy shop, but at the time when I had 2 small children and I didn't want to go back to full-time work, it was a great way for me to use my sewing skills to earn a little bit of extra money while staying at home and being with my children, which was really what I wanted to do. So if you are a sewer, there are loads of ways to make money with your sewing. You can make personalised gifts, you can make things for around the home, you can make crafts, bags, tea towels, table runners. Those were the things I started with back in the early days of my shop, Poppy and Primrose, and it really did grow and it took off, and it was a really nice way of making money for me while I was at home with my children. And not only for the money side of things, it did give me something to focus on and something to do and something for myself. Well, not something to do, I didn't need something to do, I was very busy with 2 children, but it was something that I could have sort of for myself, growing my own little business and making money in that way. So if you are looking to make more money with your sewing skills, or even just to make money so that you can buy more fabric and do more sewing, it's definitely something that you could look into. You could also look into taking in people's alterations and doing little sewing jobs and things for them. That's not actually something that I've ever dabbled in, because I hate doing alterations. And it's that thing, isn't it? As soon as people know that you sew, they start asking you to hem their jeans and take things in and things like that. And I've always said no to that, I'm afraid. That's not for me. But I think selling crafts and selling things you make is a really lovely way to make an extra bit of cash, if you can do that. My next tip, which could be a bit of a controversial one, is don't make twirls. So, okay, this is personal preference, but I think for me, I hardly ever make a twirl unless I really, really need to. So I did make one when I made a coat last year. I made a twirl out of an old bed sheet that I had. But really day to day, and the things that I make, even if I'm making a new pattern, I'll very, very rarely make a twirl. So the reason why I don't make twirls, even of new garments, is just because for me, it feels as though it's a waste of money. So essentially, if I want to try a new pattern before I make my final version, I would then be needing to buy another load of fabric to make that test version, and then make it again with another lot of fabric. So for me, it just makes more sense, even if I'm using a slightly more pricey fabric, to just go for it. At the end of the day, even if I waste that money on that more expensive fabric, it probably hasn't cost me as much as buying extra fabric to make as well. So that's the way that I look at things anyway. And I know that you could definitely look at it the other way around and say that, well, actually, if your garment goes wrong, then you've then wasted the money by wasting your lovely material, because you could have tested it out and got it right first. So there's definitely that argument. But I think for me, especially if I'm making something that doesn't involve a lot of fitting, I find that it makes much more sense for me to just go in and start making and alter where I can along the way. So that's just another tip, and probably personal preference for me, because I know that not everyone will feel that way. But for me, it just doesn't make sense really to buy extra fabric for just making twirls. My next tip is kind of one that goes without saying really, but it is to reuse, refashion and recycle. If you want to save money in your sewing journey, it obviously makes sense to use clothing or old sheets or items from a charity shop or something. So in charity shops, you can often get lovely remnants of fabrics, or even old curtains or tablecloths and bed sheets and things like that, that you can use for practice in your sewing journey. So I think particularly in the beginning, this is a really great way to save money. So rather than buying a fabric straight from a fabric store, you could use old clothing. So for example, you could use a piece of adult's clothing and chop it right down to the seams and refashion it to make an item of clothing for a child, say, because obviously you'd need less fabric for that. Likewise, if you do have garments in your wardrobe that you're not reaching for and you're not wearing, think about how you could refashion them so that you do get more wear out of them. So you can make dresses into tops, you could put sleeves in, you can take sleeves out, you can shorten things. Likewise, you could even lengthen something, really. If you wanted to make something into a maxi dress, you could make it into a nice colour-blocked maxi dress or something like that. This is, again, something that I know I need to be better at, because there are garments in my wardrobe that I'm not refashioning into something that I would wear more. And that's probably because I'm just not spending the time on it, really. I'm more taken by making new things than I am of sorting out my older things. So I'm talking to myself here as well, that I do need to reuse, refashion and recycle in my own life too. My next and final tip is to apply for brand ambassadorships with fabric companies, or guest bloggers or bloggers for fabric companies if you can. So often fabric companies will have openings for guest bloggers or brand ambassadors, and they'll often put out posts on their Instagram, say, or their website or whatever, saying that they require brand ambassadors. So if you feel as though you would like to do that, what often happens is that the fabric company will send you some fabric for free of charge on a gifted basis, and then you will be asked to make something with that fabric and then often share it on Instagram, write up a blog post or an article or something reviewing the fabric and saying what you made and how you found it and everything. And that will often then be reposted on the fabric company's website or Instagram. So obviously that's a great way of getting fabric in exchange for some work, essentially, because you are working by way of promoting that fabric company's fabric. But also, if you are trying to grow your own brand, so if you have your own blog or your own Instagram page or anything like that, it's often a great way to get publicity for yourself as well, because the fabric company will often reshare onto their own website or onto Instagram, and therefore other people see your work, and therefore it can often work that it tends to grow your brand and your accounts as well. So that's just another option that you could look at if you do want to save money in your own sewing journey. So those are my top 10 tips for saving money in your sewing journey. I hope you've enjoyed this video today. It was going to be another top 5, but then when I thought about it, I had more than 5 tips to share, so I made it into a top 10 instead. I'd love to know in the comments what your top tips for saving money are in your sewing journey. So please do comment below and let us all know how you tend to save money in your sewing journey. Otherwise, I'll leave the video here and say have a lovely day, everyone, and I'll look forward to seeing you in my next video. Bye.